You are the salt of the earth, but if its salt loses its flavor, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled on by people. You are the light of the world. A city located on a hill cannot be hid. People do not light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before people, so that they can see your good deeds and be honored in your Father in heaven.
Gracious and loving God, we come before you. Our desire is to worship you in spirit and truth. And we invite you through your Holy Spirit to come into our presence and worship with us. Help us to worship you. Our desire, Lord, is to bring our worship to you as an offering, as a gift. So bless us, Lord, and may you be blessed for being here with us. In Christ's name, amen. We're going to continue standing, number 275, if you brought a hymnal with you. Otherwise, it's How Firm a Foundation. Remember them in prayer. like all of us, they are going through the same type of thing, trying to figure out how to make things work, communicate with people when you are restricted for not being in offices and all of those dynamics, and trying to make the ministry that God has called them to do as fulfilling as possible for what God has given them the opportunity to do. So in our time of silent prayer throughout the week, we just ask that you remember the Dolphins in your prayers. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I ask that you would just be encouragement to Dean and Carol. That Father, as they continue serving you as quote-unquote retired full-time workers, so retired from overseas but working here in the U.S. in retirement, I ask, Lord, that you would bless their ministry as they try to maintain contact with the 700 or so SIM missionaries. That you would bless them, Father, in their ministry. And that you would be with their extended family, Lord, as grandchildren are now have been born to many of their kids, Lord, that you would continue to watch over this family. But Father, we recognize that we are part of their family as they are part of our family. So help us, Lord, to be mindful of our own church family, the needs within our congregation. Physical needs, Lord, as well as spiritual needs, emotional needs, financial needs. Father, we sometimes forget when we gather here that we're all coming from different places at different times with different concerns, family situations, Lord, work situations, physical situations, Father, where we just need your Holy Spirit to come fresh on us. Father, that we would be comforted from all those different things that we experience. And that we wouldn't be afraid to turn it over to you, Lord. Our anxieties, our pain, our suffering, job situations, whatever comes into our minds, Lord, we would just have the freedom to say, yes, Lord, you take care of it. I'm going to trust you. I'm going to trust you, Lord. You're going to continue to direct our paths. We thank you, Lord, for us just being the privilege of sharing together. And now we share the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory of God. Amen. We continue our worship. We're going to be singing.
morning.
I'm reading from John chapter 4, verses 27 through 42. Now at the very moment his disciples came back, they were shocked because he was speaking with a woman. However, no one said, "What do you want?" or "Why are you speaking with her?" Then the woman left her water jar, went off into the town, and said to the people, "Come, see a man who told me everything I ever did. Surely he can't be the Messiah, can he?" So they left the town and began coming to him. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, "Rabbi, eat something." But he said to them, "I have food to eat that you know nothing about." So the disciples began to say to one another, "No one brought him anything to eat, did they?" Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of the one who sent me and to complete his work. Don't you say, 'There are 4 more months and then comes the harvest'? I tell you, look up and see that the fields are already white for harvest. The one who reaps receives pay and gathers fruit for eternal life, so that the one who sows and the one who reaps can rejoice together. For in this instance, the saying is true, 'One sows and another reaps.' I sent you to reap what you did not work for. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor." Now many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the report of the woman who testified, "He told me everything I ever did." So when the Samaritans came to him, they began to asking him to stay with them. He stayed there 2 days, and because of his word, many more believed. They said to the woman, "No longer do we believe because of your words, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this one really is the Savior of the world."
Just a couple of notes. When Sue and I, when I wrote this, I said to Sue, I said, well, originally I was going to have her read the whole story again. And then as she read through it, it was like, okay, maybe you don't need to have the whole story. And then if you were looking up on the screen, you saw a CA in brackets after one of the passages. And just out of curiosity, because I'll just be quiet. How many saw that? It kept casting them back. And all I can simply to tell you that there's not any kind of correction in the NET. There are references all through that, and Sue usually pulls out all of the references that would be below the line if you have a study Bible. And so all that is a Greek translation that brings you to the bottom. There's probably, I have it in here, there's probably 25 to 30 of those references that are in the text. So you didn't see anything strange, except that if she put the pure text in there, you would see CA, the next phrase would be CB, CC, CD. So just one of those textual things in the translation, since you're not quite as familiar as that. So let me pray with you. Father, we ask you take this wonderful story. We want all of your word, Lord, always, but that you would go ahead, Father, give us insight, give us understanding. Allow your Holy Spirit, who's present here, to work on our hearts and minds. Help us to forget about ourselves. Help us to yield to you in your word. And that can be a challenge for each one of us. So thank you for that. In Christ's name, amen. In the year 258 AD, Emperor Valerian issued an anti-Christian decree condemning all Christian clergy and workers to death unless they renounced their faith in Jesus Christ. Lawrence was one of the 7 deacons in Rome at that time, And his ministry reflected the work of the deacons in that first century in Jerusalem. He had the responsibility of feeding and caring for the poor. Four deacons refused to recant and were executed. They left Lawrence alone for a few days, thinking that he might know the location of the quote-unquote secret treasures of the Christians. When the prefect of Rome finally confronted Lawrence, he ordered him to hand over the church's treasures. So Lawrence gathered together the lame, the blind, the sick, the poor, the widows and orphans, and brought them to the Roman official. These are the riches of the church. Needless to say, Rome killed the deacon Lawrence. Now, how do we perceive the riches of the Christian church? Do we see people as the riches, the same way God sees other people? Do we see them as the wealth of God? In order to do that well, to see people how God sees them, we need to continue to remove the barriers like fear, like unbelief, our prejudices, and we now need to start seeing them as God sees them. We often refer in Genesis that we are created in the image of God, and that's often how people respond. Well, we're all created in God's image. What we usually fail to notice is that we are also created and meant to be created in his likeness. Now, most people have no problem with the image of God, but when it comes to his likeness, I really believe what we're talking about there is a spiritual birth. Last week in the story of the woman of the well, as we are now spending a second week on this, we saw Jesus reach out to someone who really wasn't walking down the right path. She didn't know the truth of who Jesus was. But Jesus met her, and she, where she was, right there at the well, didn't go ahead and say, you know, you need to clean yourself up. And he told her the truth. Told her the truth about herself, which created a little stir, I'm sure. But then also told them the truth about himself. And his hope was that she would choose the right path. Jesus had a vision for the people of the world who needed to hear the truth of God's word. And the world for Jesus was wherever he was at any given time. And the world for you and me, if we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, is wherever we are. And that hasn't changed in 2,000 years. Our mission is our location. For 5 weeks, we've been looking at reawakening the church and the barriers that hold us back. And well, one of the barriers that hold us back is what I want to call status quo faith. Jesus reached across cultural, racial, social barriers with the good news that Jesus is the Messiah, that Jesus is the Christ, the anointed one of God, the Savior of the world. And the woman at the well, she had, for all extents and purposes, had status quo faith. She was comfortable in her Samaritan faith. But with Jesus, she becomes a world-class Christian. And my hope this morning as we look at the reawakening of the church is that you want to be a world-class Christian and break down the barrier of status quo faith. Christian author Paul Barthwick defines a world Christian as one whose lifestyle and obedience are compatible and in accord with what God is doing and wants to do in our world. I think sometimes we think about, yeah, I'm all about what God is doing, It's the part of what he wants to do in our world. Well, I had the privilege of meeting Paul Barthwick. He was at that time the missions pastor at Grace Chapel in Lexington, Massachusetts. And I had a mission team up in that area in Boston, high school students and some adults. We happened to go to their church. He happened to be speaking. He wasn't always the pastor preaching. And I asked him if he'd want to sit down with a group of students. And he gave me an hour of his time after a Sunday evening service. The challenge he gave us in looking at missions, he told us to be a student of the world and to realize that reaching out to the world can get very, very lonely. And I thought about that, and I've thought about it for years. A world-class Christian is not one we might perceive as the elite of Christianity, the stars, but rather the servant of Christianity. I mentioned Dana and Carol Belton. It's one thing to be overseas and support a missionary in Zambia, but you support a missionary in South Carolina who's retired, and their primary responsibility is keeping in touch the other 700 or so SIM missionaries. Doesn't sound as elite as being the missionary overseas. But a world-class Christian dreams of ways of ministering to others and shares God's heart for the world. The woman at the well became a world-class Christian after her encounter with Jesus. So this morning I want to share with you two attributes of being a world-class Christian. The first attribute of being a world-class Christian is to know the whole story of salvation. Of course, that sounds pretty basic, but and it is. And of course, Jesus would know the whole story of salvation, but what's important in our text is that Jesus told the whole story by filling in the parts that were missing and corrected the parts that were in error for the woman at the well. In verse 19, and I know we didn't read that, the woman was correct in saying that the Samaritans worshipped at the mountain, and the Jews worshipped in Jerusalem. The Samaritans rejected the Old Testament. And last week I told you they accepted the first five books of the Old Testament, but they rejected the history, they rejected the words of the prophets, the major prophets and the minor prophets. That was not part of them. They just accepted those first five books. They believed in the one true God, but did not accept his complete revelation. In verse 25, we see the woman acknowledging a coming Messiah, but the Samaritans believed that he would be a Messiah of information, not the Messiah of salvation. The Messiah the Samaritans were looking for would be like Moses, as described in Deuteronomy 18:18, where it says, "I will raise up a prophet like you for them from among their fellow Israelites. I will put my words in his mouth, and he will speak to them whatever I command." In other words, this Messiah would be simply speaking God's word. In verse 25, the woman says to Jesus, "I know that the Messiah is coming, the one called Christ." And if you remember at the beginning of the year when we looked at the term Christ and Jesus' name as the Christ, simply the Greek version of Messiah, the Hebrew version. So she wasn't referring at that point to Jesus. And she continues and says, "Whenever he comes, he will tell us everything." By not accepting God's full revelation, the Samaritans knew very little about God's purpose and his promises. Jesus made it clear that the Samaritans' religion was in error. Sometimes we don't, when we see a friend or someone talks to us, but we don't want to go ahead and tell them, like, "You're wrong." He just made it clear that she was in error. He stated to the woman at the well that the Samaritan worshiped what they do not know. In other words, they had no idea why or who they were really worshiping. Their knowledge of worship was stymied because they didn't know the whole truth. So Jesus goes ahead and in black and white lays it out for her. He says basically the Jews have it right. Salvation will come through the Jews. The Messiah would be a Jew. But Jesus didn't stop there and say, hey, your religion is wrong and mine is right. He went on to explain that even the Jews who are looking for a Messiah are going to learn that worship will not be about a location like Jerusalem and in the temple, but worship will be about God and worshiping Him in spirit and truth. And then Jesus declares to this Samaritan woman the fulfillment of who the Messiah is by declaring that He, Jesus, is the Messiah. Like, I'm the Messiah. He's the one who is God's source of salvation for both the Jew and the Samaritan. That is a powerful revelation. That is the full story of God's plan. Salvation was to come through one man, Jesus the Messiah. Salvation will not only come through Jesus' words, but also His life, and eventually His death, and His resurrection. Do you know the whole story of salvation? You see, too often I hear a Samaritan mentality within the broad spectrum, the broad context of Christianity. An acceptance of part of the scripture, but not all of it. We think we are so unique and intellectual that somehow or other we have figured out ways to cut out the parts of the Bible that don't really fit into our worldview. That's what the Samaritans did. And eventually concerning the Messiah, that's what the Jews did also. And if we look at Christianity today in its broadest picture, we see the whittling apart of God's word to fit the patterns of the world's standards. And the more we stand on God's word, the more we potentially will face persecution. The more we will face being ostracized by friends, by neighbors, and family. And then I usually ask, and I was just talking to somebody yesterday, that too often we treat the Bible as a cafeteria plan. We like to pick and choose the parts that taste good, that are palatable. It's like going to a Chinese buffet and saying, not that, not that, ooh, not that, ooh. And when it comes to Scripture, and then I think about it, what gives us the right to pick and choose what to believe or what we believe out of God's word of truth? Being a world-class Christian is not based on trying to be like Jesus because Jesus was a good person and humanity would be better off if we all act like Jesus. I met a youth pastor who said, yeah, all you have to be, youth, is be like Jesus. And I remember going to him and saying, well, what about salvation? Well, really, I don't really believe that part about the cross. And I'm like, really? And they were like, yeah, the idea would be just to follow Jesus as a good example. Being a world-class Christian is about understanding the whole story of salvation. The fact that we are sinners and that the sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross was about our forgiveness and the opportunity for us to choose to receive eternal life. It's realizing that this book that we call God's Word, the Holy Bible, that God gave us, is a whole story. That the Old Testament and New Testament come together and identify the plan of salvation that God has for us. And that it was fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And that God gave us His Word. And we are called to believe the whole story. That's what the woman at the well did, and it changed her life. And she began the journey of being a world-class Christian. The second attribute of a world-class Christian is knowing that God has a task for you. It's interesting, but there are right tasks, and there are right tasks. Now, if Cassie's following along, she's like, well, no, that's not what he wrote in the manuscript. There was right tasks and right tasks for the church, or in the church. And as I was practicing this morning, I realized, I really know there are right tasks, and there are right tasks. And you're like, what's he saying? Well, the difference is based on having God's vision rather than our own. In the context of our text in John 4, we know that Jesus had come to the well in Sychar in the Samaritan region while the disciples went off to get food. They were hungry. They were doing a right task. For all intents and purposes, they were doing the right thing. We've been walking, it's getting to be close to noon, we're hungry, let's go get some food. Mid-afternoon, hunger pangs, and looks what happens when they get back. Verse 31, Rabbi, eat something. And Jesus tells them that he has food that they don't know about. That's what I'd need. You know, cooking for a church meal, having Jesus come in and like, hey, I've got a nice plate of turkey here for you. Oh yeah, I already had some tea. What do you mean? I've been cooking all day. And the disciples are like, we went out there, we got food. So the disciples talked among themselves. It's one of the things in scripture that I love. It's like, all right, we don't have a clue what Jesus is saying. Let's talk among ourselves. We'll get this sorted out. And then they thought someone else must have brought food to Jesus. Think about it. Can you imagine doing that? Being one of the disciples, been following along, you head into the city, you bring a nice meal, you bought the chocolate chip cookies at McDonald's for three for a dollar, you got the important part of the meal for Jesus. You plan to eat with Jesus, and then Jesus tells them, oh, by the way, I have food, and Jesus says, my food is to do the will of God. The disciples were doing the right task. But Jesus showed them the right task through God's vision, to do the will of God. Right now, God calls each one of us to do his will. That is always the right task. So what was God's task for Jesus that day? To bring salvation to the Samaritans. And what was the task of the disciples? Verse 38, Jesus tells the disciples to understand that they are to be reapers, that they are to be harvesters, not of a physical harvest, but of a spiritual harvest. That there were sowers and reapers, and that the sowers had been doing their work, and that the fields were ready, they were ripe to be harvested. That was God's task for them. And it hasn't changed for 2,000 years. The task for each of us that God's word makes so very plain is to basically be sowing or harvesting. A world-class Christian has a vision for sowing seeds of faith or harvesting a crop of eternal life. In verse 39, we read that many Samaritans believed in Jesus because of the woman's testimony. Even with her reputation, and we saw last week, it was very colorful, she told those in her community, in her town, in her village, about Jesus. When Jesus changes our life, we are to tell others. The woman of the well took on the task of being a world-class Christian. So, what is God's task for you? Well, we have our church's mission statement, and it's printed in your bulletin. I think it's on the screen. It'll be on the screen behind me. Somewhere in this statement, I really do believe, the task that God is calling you to do is evident. And I'm going to ask you to read it with me. So if it's easier on the screen or it's easier in the bulletin, you're going to stay seated, but we're going to read this together. The purpose of this church shall be to worship God, to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, and to celebrate the sacraments, to promote Christian fellowship and unity within this church and the church universal, to render loving service toward mankind, and to strive for righteousness, justice, and peace. To these ends, the congregation shall provide suitable church, chapel, and related facilities, disseminate religious and moral instruction, and establish, maintain, and conduct educational opportunities for such purposes, practicing loving service toward the needs of both at home and abroad. Support such benevolent, charitable, and philanthropic activities as may from time to time be deemed desired. That's what we say is the purpose of our church. And I'm sure all of you have been members for a long time and said, well, yeah, I remember doing that. But I'm going to ask, we're going to read it again. You'll see that there are phrases that are in italics. This church and the congregation. At least in the bulletin. Are they in italics?
Should be.
Yeah. All right. So I'm going to have you read it again. But instead of going ahead and reading it just like it was, I want you to put your name where the italics are, your first and your last name. And we'll read this again together. So let's start. And it would sound like, let me start. So it'll say, the purpose of Scott Navistad. You would put your name, the purpose of Sue Navistad. So let's read this together. The purpose of Scott Navistad shall be to worship God, to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, and to celebrate the sacraments, to promote Christian fellowship and unity within this church and the church universal, to render loving service toward mankind, and to strive for righteousness, justice, and peace. To these ends, Scott Navistad shall provide suitable church, chapel, and related facilities, disseminate religious and moral instruction, and establish, maintain, and conduct educational opportunities for such purposes. Practice loving service towards the needs both at home and abroad. Support such benevolent, charitable, and philanthropic activities as may from time to time be deemed desired. Do you know why we can read it this way with our name there? Because you and I are the church. We are the body of Christ. And we have a task. When I was a cook, quote unquote professionally, years and years ago, I knew that at that time I had a task from God. That yes, I had a job, I had a vocation as a cook, but the task from God was to share my faith with those around me. So a better example would probably be my dad, since I ended up being a cook for 6 months before I went overseas as a missionary. My dad was an electrical engineer. That was his vocation. That's what he had studied for. That's what he had trained for. But his task was to share Christ with his co-workers, to share Christ with whoever he was, wherever he was. I used to have people over the years, well, was your dad a pastor? No, my dad wasn't a pastor. He was an electrical engineer who shared Christ. Because that's what his faith was about, and that was the task. So are the tasks you're doing at St. Paul Church or through St. Paul Church being done for the purpose of bringing glory to God? Are you serving on a board or teaching a class or participating in a program to bring glory to God? The things that you're doing at home, the things that you do at work, are they things that you're doing to bring, and the goal is to bring people to Christ? Are you nurturing your faith? Are you praying on a regular basis? Are you spending time in God's Word? We had better be doing that so that we can be equipped to minister and be ready to serve for the task that God has already given us. So if you're a student, I know school is back up, are you praying for your teachers? Are you praying for your bus driver, for the cafeteria lady, which all of a sudden I wrote this and I thought, all right, that sounds sexist. Men, you never hear about the cafeteria man. It's just one of those things that kind of bother you. No matter your vocation, God has a task for you in the midst of it. The fact is that the focus of your involvement at St. Paul Church should be going about the tasks that God has called you to, that God has given you, that God has plans for you. And for many of you, it's not just St. Paul Church that you're involved, but it's the community where you volunteer, where you help, where you coach, where you do all, where you ref. All of these things are missions that God calls us to. And God's willing to continue to provide world-class Christians the tasks that he has for them. Paul Bothwell then, in his book that he wrote, in The Grapes of Wrath, John Steinbeck summarizes the lives of several people with the tragic words, "When they died, it was as if they had never lived. They made no impact, left no legacy, affected no lives." He continues, "We fear Steinbeck's tragic epitaph, but the solution to our fears is found in Jesus as we give ourselves to be his world-class followers. We can be his agents of change in our broken world." So yes, the woman at the well, she becomes a world-class Christian in spite of her past. And she leaves a legacy. Men and women in her town come to know Jesus because of her testimony. She learned the whole story of salvation and worked at the task of being a witness for God. So, as I said earlier, my hope is that we become world-class Christians. Are you a world-class Christian? Do you know and believe the whole story of salvation? Are you sharing it with others? Are you going about doing God's tasks for your life? Are you ready to break out of status quo faith? My prayer is that St. Paul Church will gain a reputation in this community of being a church filled with world-class Christians. Men and women, young and old, who know the whole story of salvation and are willing to accept it, share it, and serve God within their community, being a witness and sharing the faith. One woman brought a change to the Samaritan village in Sychar and to the group of Samaritans that would go out from there. We can be the one church that can change the area all around us, beginning with neighbors, friends, and family. Would you pray with me, please? Help us, Lord, each one of us, to be that person, to be that world-class Christian who unapologetically hears God speak to them, have their lives changed, whether it's today or years and years ago, as many have come into a relationship with Christ many, many years ago. Rekindle, Lord, through your Holy Spirit, the fire of faith, wanting to share the hope that they have, not just for today, but for all eternity. Help us, Lord, to be the agents of change to those around us. In Christ's name, amen. As we close our worship service today, we're going to sing Fill My Cup, Lord. It's number 398. But the first verse is all about the woman at the well. She was seeking for things that did not satisfy. But then she heard her Savior speaking, "Draw from my well that will never run dry." And then, of course, in the chorus, "Fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up." That's what he calls us to do today. Let's stand and sing, "Fill my cup, Lord."
What do you want me to do right here, right now?
and for the vocation that you've given